welcome everybody to the January 4th tri-board meeting. So we have with us members from the Select Board, Finance Committee, and School Committee. And for our agenda this evening, we're going to be talking about a policy for free cash, stabilization fund. We're going to be discussing revenues and upcoming all-boards meeting to be held later this month, as well as the annual town meeting. So should we start with free cash?
Certainly. So we've had a number of discussions about the budget in general. One of the sore points or flash points in our discussion has been the appropriate use of free cash, which we have used in the past for both capital projects and one-time expenditures, but also for operating expenses. So I thought it would be helpful if we clarified our free cash policy. We have many financial policies, but none that addresses free cash specifically. So I cast about for a suitable town for a model by which we should pattern our free cash policy. I found the town of Northborough, which is a very well-managed town, has the equivalent of a AAA credit rating, but yet they were using free cash to balance their budget, their operating budget, and so they put together a few years back a free cash policy whereby they would reduce their reliance upon free cash by a certain amount per year until they had reached a zero free cash going into the operating budget. They also outlined appropriate uses of free cash. And so I thought that that was a very, and I had a chance to talk to the town administrator there, Mr. John Coderre, about this. And so I thought that was an appropriate model. And so I put together a draft policy, which we then had the financial management team review. They made some suggestions. And I think this is a good process for the town of Hadley. You know how it is. With the legislature, they may pass a law and then they pass it down to you to implement it, and you don't know what they mean, and things are unclear, and contradictions exist within the law. This is more of a homegrown grassroots policy that came up through your financial management team. It then went to the Select Board. The Select Board looked at it. They recommended that it go to the Finance Committee. Finance Committee reviewed it and approved it and sent it back to the Select Board. The Select Board decided that we should have a tri-board, that we should take action on it in a tri-board. So the policy consists of two general parts. First part is the definition part, because we often mean different things when we use the term free cash. And for the people who are watching on TV, free cash means it's money left over at the end of the year, which is in the form of cash. It's not in IOUs or promissory notes or lines of credit. And it's free in the sense of not that it's just freely appearing, but it is free of encumbrances. There are no earmarks associated with this particular money. So free cash is leftover money at the end of the year, in the form of cash, and there are no obligations associated with it. Free cash can consist of one-time revenues. It can also consist of recurring revenues. It's usually a blend of both, but it's theoretically possible that in 1 year it could be 100% one-time revenue, and in some other year could be 100% recurring revenue. So the policy is that free cash should be used in a declining amount by $100,000 each year for the operating budget until such time as that the annual appropriation of free cash for the operating budget is lowered to zero. So there would be no free cash used to fund the operating budget. And just for a little bit of context, we used about $157,000 of free cash for the operating budget for this fiscal year. So we're talking about in a 2 years time frame, if we're able to maintain our targets, we would be able to get to zero. So that means you would have extra free cash lying around, what would be an appropriate use for the free cash? Appropriate use would be for the appropriated reserve, that's the Finance Committee's reserve account under Mass General Law, Chapter 40, Section 6. It could be used for capital projects. It could be used to replenish or fund the stabilization fund. It could be used to fund capital projects by cash rather than by issuing debt for smaller items. And when I say smaller items, we're talking about dump trucks for $50,000 or thereabouts. It can be used for augmenting trust funds related to fringe benefits and unfunded liabilities related to employee fringe benefits, which are really one-time expenses. So we're talking about the unfunded liability of OPEB and the unfunded liability for the pension. Could be used for extraordinary deficits to fund any potential deficits that might otherwise be carried over from one fiscal year to the next. And a good example of that would be in a particularly severe winter, we may have a deficit in snow and ice that would be carried over from one year to the next, and that would have to be picked up by the taxpayers in the next year. Free cash would avoid that unnecessary expense to the taxpayers. And then finally, for emergency appropriations to allow for fiscal flexibility, which is important for any well-run town. So that is it in a nutshell. The Financial Management Team recommends this. The Finance Committee recommends it. What is the pleasure of the board?
Well, I think the reason we brought it forward, there were a couple of members of the board who wanted the opportunity to discuss it with the Finance Committee. Yeah. So did anybody have any questions for Mark or Amy?
I actually do. Is $100,000 a year too aggressive? Should we do it for 50? I mean, at 50 will be a 3-year term as opposed to a 2-year term, and I think it'll allow a little more flexibility with it. Does anybody have a problem with that, or do you think we're in a race to get there?
I think going at it aggressively would be we'd achieve it in a much more expedient way, and it would be like a one-time swallow. The second one won't be so bad. But if we could do it, let's get that done.
Linda?
I have the same thought as Jerry. It seems, I think it's a very worthy goal. It seems aggressive considering we have not gone back to a fall town meeting without using free cash in how many years?
Ever.
So I think it's a great goal. It seems aggressive.
I'm inclined to agree with Mr. Klepacki. I think we've got to be aggressive. We haven't taken any money into stabilization since 2012. We've taken money out. All we do is come in the fall town meeting and make all kinds of expenditures. Maybe we shouldn't even be making them. We should be more conservative as a governing body instead of being so spendthrift. You know, I think we've got to take a hard look and see what the citizens are doing January 12th with these ballot questions. That's going to give us a good indication what we're up against, I think, after those ballot votes, you know, and maybe we could hold off till after the ballot vote before we make a decision tonight. We don't have to rush into this tonight, and we'll get a clearer picture of just what our money situation is after that ballot vote.
I certainly don't think that this town has been spendthrift. We've kind of held the toe on a lot of different things. We haven't expended on our equipment for the town highway. We haven't done anything to enhance we're just starting to enhance our infrastructure for our police and our fire. The schools are still looking to do things there. I mean, that's an older school. You know, we were over there, we tried to do an addition and things like that. I mean, everything to keep kids up to date on their education, you have to put into education, you have to put into these things. We've let our buildings go. You can't just not ignore these things anymore. And so not using, I can see putting some money into free cash or taking it, splitting it. I'm kind of with Jerry on this with the $50,000 for this year to get it started, because there's so many other things, and not knowing, I'm not going to start dismantling what we have built already. And I think that it would be a shame to do that at this point.
Point of order, the election's the 10th, right?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I ask just a question, just from a practical standpoint? So I'm looking at the bullets and what we can use what the policy would suggest we use free cash for. And you were talking about the appropriated reserve and gave the example of the Finance Committee Reserve Fund. Now, that reserve fund has been anywhere from $50,000 to $90,000, I think, as long as I've been involved in the town.
It's 50 this year.
50 this year, because we brought it back down, right? But that's currently being funded from operating budget, right? So in theory, are we suggesting that we could reduce that line item to zero and then fund that with free cash in the fall?
Yeah, so I
I'm not saying we're necessarily doing it, but I mean, that's...
I think so. Keeping it at least 50 is a good idea, because it may for any unexpected event, right? That we don't want to have, there could be an event between spring and fall.
Sure. Right, and you want to enhance that.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're not talking about eliminating it from the operating budget. It's just if we wanted to bring it from 50 to 75 because of some unexpected, then the 25 would come from free cash in the fall. Is that what we're thinking?
Well, you have to pass the budget in spring town meeting, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. Yeah.
So you got to have that reserve already in place.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to run it to zero and then have something happen and us be scrambling.
Yeah. How would people feel about splitting the difference and going to 75?
Well, it's not going to the difference. It's 100. Well, we're only splitting the difference at 50. Where'd you go, school?
No. The difference between the suggestion 100. Of 50 and the 100, splitting
yeah.
that, and so that we're trying to... I mean, I understand what where the Finance Committee is coming from.
Still gets you there in 2 years.
It's still going to get us there in 2 years,
yeah.
But it's, you know, a little bit more... palatable.
I'm still with the 50. I think, you know, I don't think we need to jump gung-ho at it. I think we're being aggressive with OPEB. We're putting money into that at big amounts each year, which no other surrounding town is doing. We're taking money and putting it where it should be, but I don't think that we have to be as aggressive with this.
One of the things that I think the Building Maintenance Committee would like to point out over and over again is the fact that the building maintenance doesn't get done,
mm-hmm.
and that they feel that there needs to be a line item there for somewhere, for a number somewhat more than what we have right now at $66,000, so that things get accomplished, so we don't have things go by the wayside and maintenance gets deferred, and eventually we end up spending big money on capital purchases for things that should have just been maintained better.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that if we can find other alternatives for the excess money, whether your number goes from 50 to 75 or goes to 100 or something like that, and they come to you for requests for capital purchases or for emergency repairs to air conditioning units and things like that we had this year, where $50,000 is gone in one repair. It's one repair of the air conditioner over there.
$50,000 is a drop in the bucket.
It's true. And so... anything that we
today.
Can do, I think, to that's just one. I mean, I'm not here. That's just one thing that I think is gets deferred. And here we are. We're gung ho, and we want to get this taken care of. And I completely agree with you. But I think things are getting deferred. I think it's an opportunity for us to work towards something, but not to get jumped there too fast. And other things can get accomplished in the meantime.
And really, what we're talking is doing it over a 3-year period instead of a 2-year period.
Correct. Correct.
So. I mean, I know the financial management team put a lot of work into this as well, so does anybody...
What was their recommendation?
This was the policy, the recommendation. Right. But what about the finance committee, too?
You know, there's a lot of unanswered questions, Madam Chair. How are we going to attack OPEB? You know, last year, I give a lot of credit to our treasurer. She stuck to her guns,
mm-hmm.
and we put, like, you know, $260,000 towards it, which was a real positive thing for our credit rating and everything. And
well,
I think we have to continue to do that.
Third year in a row.
There was a plan.
Yeah.
There's a plan with the OPEB when we first started it
yeah,
to increase it each year by X amount of money. Isn't that how we started it?
And it's in the operating budget.
It is, but it came very close to getting pulled out so we could balance our budget.
Well,
that's what I'm saying.
But
we have to be more aggressive to cover all this. You know, I know we had some discussion, but I don't think we ever took a vote saying an override is completely out of the question.
Well,
it's in documents saying we are, but I don't remember taking a vote.
Maybe.
You know, if there's... a consensus on these ballot questions of people supporting those ballot questions, then they may even support an override. We don't know this hypothetically, you know, and then we could satisfy, you know, we lost a SAFER grant for 4 firefighters. That's the most important thing. We've got to get them at least 2 in this budget to build that fire department. We've taken care of the police department. They're almost at full core. We've got to do that with the fire department. So we've got to get the whole big picture, and I think we got to remain aggressive. We have to.
But I think maybe we should take a step back and go back to why we're even talking about a free cash policy right now. And I believe, and somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but what we were trying to do is make sure that it's easy when you get in caught up in the, well, quite frankly, the emotion of the annual budget process, because people are looking for money. We can't always, you know, meet all the needs of the requests that are out there. And the concern was that free cash was being used as, you know, effectively a plug, and that there was no policy on free cash, in that you don't want to start talking about a policy when you're already in the throes of the budget process. And last year we had a lot of conversation about stabilization, you know, do we have enough, do we have too much, would we ever be in a situation where we actually might take some money out of stabilization? I think we collectively all said no. I mean, no one's interested in draining down stabilization. But I think that the point was that we wanted to establish a policy in advance of the budget process so that we would all collectively look at each other and say, this is what we're agreeing to, so that there was instruction to the town administrator in the budget preparation process so he would know what was on the table or off the table. Because last year, if you recall, the town administrator came right out of the gate using free cash, and there was some upset about that. So I think what we're trying to do is agree on a policy, and this policy, if I'm reading it right, I mean, it says it allows for the unexpected and emergencies. So I think it's very appropriate for us to establish a policy now, if we can agree. I think the only thing we're talking about is it $50,000 or $100,000? And I don't think it has really anything to do with the outcome of the ballot on 10th or anything else. We just need to know what the ground rules are going into the budget season. And that's what I was hoping to accomplish with the policy.
Madam Chair, it's also our responsibility as elected officials to provide a balanced budget to the townspeople out of the annual town meeting. What's been going on for the last 6 years is exactly what the Department of Revenue tells you not to do.
It's better than what it was 25 years ago. That's for
25
sure.
Years ago, we had balanced budgets, right, and money was going into stabilization.
And you spent down 25 years ago, you spent down stabilization till you had nothing in it.
Okay, Heather, nothing. You had something you wanted to say?
Yeah, this policy is exactly in line with what you said. We're trying to provide a balanced budget without seeing this as the source to plug this gap.
Right.
And that's what you're trying to do, is put a policy around that, much as we've done the same thing with our school choice funds.
I agree. This is where this policy come about, because of Mr. Wiskiewicz and me yelling. He's been yelling for 4 years, and I've been yelling for a year. So people are beginning to listen, so now a free cash policy is being created. And I agree, we've got to be aggressive. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, just a little different angle on it, too, is that what has happened the last couple of years, we're talking about use of the free cash in the budget, but the real pain of it was getting down to, what, $10, $11, $2, leaving town meeting with just less than $25 in the free cash. So I think that was also, as much as anything, that's a motivation for establishing a policy, is not to get down to zero.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, maybe, you know, not that I want to change it up at all, but maybe it's easier to think of it in terms of how much do we want to leave there, rather than how much do we want to decrease from the budget, because I think that's been hard to get a handle on. But I think if the goal is you got to leave $50,000 or $100,000, something more than $2 or $11 in the last couple of years, maybe that's a starting point as we're going forward and refining the use of free cash, at least to have a bottom line policy of we're not spending down to zero. Let's know that it's common sense to leave a certain amount in there so that if we have it, that we have it there to spend on articles at the next town meeting.
I like that idea.
So
setting a floor of some kind.
Yeah, that's it.
So in the game of pool, it's not the shot that you sink, it's the shot you set yourself up for. By adopting this policy and following it, you're going to be setting yourself up for the scenario that you talked about, that you will have free cash carried forward so that you can be using it for your capital requests and not having necessarily having to go back to town meeting in the fall for budget adjustments. So that's the future. That's what this policy will produce for you in a period of some years.
But I think what I'm hearing and what I like about Linda's suggestion is it happens to be that we used $157,000 this year. So the way the policy is written right now, if we stuck with 100, then we would only be able to use 57,000 of free cash.
Yeah.
Which is a somewhat arbitrary number that's attached to really nothing, because free cash flows. I mean, we have an expectation of what's going to come in, but you really don't know until July, August, until certified, what the figure even is.
In July.
And I think by attacking it the way that Linda just suggested is, rather than reduce it by a somewhat arbitrary number of 50 or 100, what we're saying is, regardless of what free cash is, we're not going to spend it down to nothing. And then, again, now we can argue for that 50 or 75 or 100, but that you always leave something in free cash, and then the variable is going this way. And I think I like that better.
Now, what you're referring to, Madam Chair, is just the omnibus budget, the 157 that went towards that, you're saying? But we actually used 542,000 from free cash to balance our whole budget for next year.
We're talking about the operating portion.
Yeah, the operating, that's what we're talking about. But we still used $542,000 to balance our whole budget, not just the operating.
We used it for capital.
We used it for a lot of things.
And OPEB.
Right.
Unfunded liability.
But my problem is, when we leave annual town meeting and we're waiting for fall, if we have something catastrophic happen, just the economy doing a flip-flop, we could go from 500,000 to 250,000 overnight that 7 months. And then where do we come up? I guess we drain it out of stabilization, which to me is a sacred cow.
Linda?
It seems like consensus in the room is that everyone agrees there should be a free cash policy, but it sounds like it ought to be revised and readdressed using Linda's idea of what is left instead of what is not going to be used.
That's my thought, and I saw some heads nodding out
here. I did too.
But how does...
I think it should be a goal. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and not just an arbitrary what is left.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. I mean, you just let it go as what is left. We'll get back down to $12.
Right.
You know? Mm-hmm. So you have to use that through the whole process to make sure that free cash is going to stay there.
Mm-hmm.
So we have that as a reserve.
I agree.
I don't think anybody's against the policy in this room. You know, but coming up with a figure of what is adequate is the question, I think.
I think we could live with the compromise of 75.
Okay. And Roby, did you?
I just think in the budget process itself that Linda's idea would be better. I'm afraid if you pick saying we have to get down 100 this year, that you're going to come up against some program, some employment. There's some employees that you're forced to cut unnecessarily.
And then you're going
to have to work with
unemployment, which is two for one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
Would
so
setting a floor be get you to where you want to be as a finance committee?
75?
Saying we're not going to spend, if you say 70, we're not going to spend it down below 75,000.
Yeah.
Right.
50?
I'm with you too. I'm with Jerry too.
Yeah.
How's everybody feel about that?
67,500.
Everybody comfortable with that?
I am.
Changing that?
I am.
Yeah?
I guess so.
Okay.
So for the clarity of the record, we've changed the 100,000 to 75.
No. And we're changing it to a floor.
That free cash will not be spent down below 75,000.
I think it's the goal.
The goal.
Right, the goal. Yeah, free cash.
The
goal
emergency appropriations to allow for fiscal flexibility.
So can we vote on that tonight with that amendment?
Sure. I would like to make a motion that we have a floor of 75,000.
A goal.
As a goal. For a free cash, for our operating budget.
And to accept the policy.
And to accept the policy as written.
All right. I'll second that.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on this?
Well, now if we can get any more feedback from the audience, it would be fine. Or is it done?
Okay. Done?
Oh, they all have to
it's
go.
It's a good start. For
I don't want to vote without their support.
Right.
It's only policy. It can be changed.
Okay, does everybody want to vote together then? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No.
No? Okay. Do you want to articulate why you're opposed, John?
Yeah. You got a great policy, but we still haven't done anything in 4 years to balance the budget. We still haven't done anything in 4 years with the money we're using after it's certified after July.
This is what the policy is for, John.
No, it's nothing you've been doing right along, Joyce.
No, we know it's not. This is what we want to do forward, and now you're not voting for a policy that everybody's in agreement with? Really, we can't please you, period.
Okay, I just wanted to understand.
I don't think that's fair, Joyce. He maybe wants a more aggressive policy. Maybe he likes the 100,000. That's why he voted no.
I did like the 100 before I was rudely interrupted by you, Joyce. And if you maintained the buildings 25 years ago, we wouldn't be in this situation.
All right, 25 years
let's
ago.
Let's move on to stabilization. So we also have we also have a stabilization policy in front of us. This David, do you want to talk about that?
So this was something that came up in discussion with the select board about stabilization policy. This is something that we adopted jointly with the finance committee on March in 2015. And briefly, the stabilization fund reserve will be established to cope with emergencies, and the reserve will be maintained at 10% of operating revenues. And there's the trend analysis to show that we've been above 10% for the last shows 5 years here, but I can tell you that it's been above 10% for 10 years. Currently, for FY15, it shows that the stabilization fund is about $2,970,000 in change, which represents a 14.27% ratio. Percentage to the net operating revenues. So I remember there was a lot of discussion with the Finance Committee at the time that this was something that everybody in the room agreed to, but maybe it's time for us to take another look at that policy.
Sure. So I think the conversation, again, leading up to this was we're almost at three times the recommendation of the Department of Revenue. However, recognizing that that's kind of, you know, their bare bones 5%, that they become quite concerned from an operating standpoint when people are below that level and are suggesting that that's a bare minimum. And we, back in 2015, the conversation, I think, was whether or not it should be targeted as a percentage of revenue. The collective agreement was yes, 10% was the amount that was arrived at. And then there was that conversation about, okay, so if we're leaving it at that and we're not adding to it over a period of time, you know, depending on the relationship between net operating revenues, but over time that 14% should be declining back towards 10%, but there was no appetite to spend down any excess and have us go to 10% and then start building back up the other way. But just recognizing that at some point down the road, but it's probably going to be quite a while, actually, we're still going to be well above 10%, right?
I think that's fine.
Well, the further conversation was is that we're missing out on grants because our fiscal responsibility is so high. So at 14.27% or 14.97 or 15.63, John and Donald had pointed out that I think it was Donald as well, but had pointed out that we're missing out on grants, and some of the information passed on to us as to why we're missing out on grants is because we're viewed as a rich community, because we are so flush in these accounts.
Yep, so I think Linda and David, you had follow-up conversation with David Eisenthal and Standard & Poor's. Do you want to share that?
So so we talked to determining a credit rating for a town involves a review of a lot of different factors. Stabilization fund is just one in many, many, many variables that that credit rating agencies take into account. But having a high credit rating is having a healthy reserve account, in this case it's a stabilization fund, having a healthy reserve account is recommended as a best practice by the Department of Revenue, by credit rating agencies, by the ICMA, and that there would be very little value to the town to artificially spend this account down. There are some other ways of looking at it that we're going to explore further, but to spend down just for the sake of lowering that amount so that that's not a good practice.
Linda, I add to it a little bit. Jerry specifically mentioned, because we're a wealthy community, or viewed as a wealthy community, that we don't suddenly not become viewed as a wealthy community because we spend $500,000 out of a stabilization account. That's based on many other factors besides what we have in a particular account. It's based on the income level of the people that live here, the professions, the jobs that people have here, the our location was being emphasized as being part of the college community and on a main road through, that some of the grants that we have been missing out on, or the as compared to the communities that have been getting that, it was specifically pointed out to us because we're not an isolated little town. We're a little town in a great location. We're not an isolated little town in the middle of nowhere. So we have resources around us. And I'm just trying to say there are many factors to it, and I don't think, we can't take one area and impoverish ourselves and then be seen differently. We are who we are.
I just needed you to say it.
Yeah, okay. we are not going to change people's income levels or our tax rate and other things.
Okay.
What was the actual figure, Linda, that you suggested through Mr. Eisenthal of the stabilization reducing to?
Oh, he didn't suggest reducing it.
If you did, to get to the percentage, how much would we be leaving in the stabilization?
Did we talk? I thought we were talking more in terms, Donald, of letting it catch up to, just leaving it where it is and let us catch up over the next few years, rather than reducing it and then having to put money back in to catch up and keep pace with increase. That we just leave it right where it is.
Well, we're talking about 10% of our operating budget, the whole budget.
Yeah, so just taking a back of the envelope sketch here, it looks like $400,000 to $500,000 to get to that 10%.
Yeah. See, I wouldn't be
in an
objection if we took money from stabilization and it went to a designated area, maybe OPEB or something like that. You know, we brought it down. But you always have to remember, if we have a breach at the dike, if we have a sewer or water main break on Route 9, we could chew up, $1 million, $2 million overnight on something like that if that happens. And again, we're not getting the grant money, as Mr. Devine said. If we have a breach on the dike, we're in big trouble.
We did get money from the state for the dike.
$800,000.
We can see from the
that was before. Then now we're not getting the grant.
We have the money
because of the money we have.
We had the money in the bank at the time, and they still gave us the money, because of the dike being what it is.
David?
So I understand that the Safer Grant, not getting the Safer Grant, was a stinging blow to the Select Board. I know that we were really counting on that because that would really help us out for a two-year period with four new people in the fire department. We didn't get it. Towns around us like Orange and Ware did get it. We're not Orange or Ware. And I'm friends with the administrators there, so I'm not throwing mud at all. But we do get grants. It's not that we are somehow not getting grants from the state or from private agencies. We were talking about the transponder grant that we just received from Maya, At the department head meeting today, we received the active shooter training grant, which was a very competitive grant. I think we're the only agency in Massachusetts who got that. So this is, so I just want to make sure that people understand that we do get grants. I understand that the SAFER grant we had pinned a lot of hope on.
No, we get them for CPA. The library has one working right now. There's grants out there, but there's more that are available that we could be applying for.
But now, since our advisors have told us that not to do it, then I
know, I understand.
I mean, I don't like the trend in that graph.
Yeah.
But we're not touching it. But you also understand, what is the percentage of that gaining money where it's sitting?
Today.
Yeah.
Hang on, that's
going to
change.
Yay, Trump.
You miss Obama already?
Okay, so again, the question was asked, and we wanted to make sure that any ideas get fair hearing. So I think the work was done to respond to the question. Linda?
I just want to bring up another topic when you're done.
Oh, okay. So, I mean, I'm comfortable leaving the policy that got voted in 2015 in place and staying the course with, we'll just let that eke down and we'll know when we're going to get close to 10%. But it's going to be several years out. But then at that point, we're going to have to address how do we keep stabilization
right.
At 10%.
Now you're going to have to increase the funding for it.
Right.
And that's going to come out of the operating budget.
I'd like a motion to that effect, Madam Chair.
Yes, please.
You make a motion, we adopt or maintain our stabilization fund reserve policy.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on that? Okay, all in favor of keeping the policy?
Aye.
Okay, Linda?
The only thing I was going to say is that, the other basically stabilization or reserve account we have in the town is the school choice account, which the way our policy reads is not as clear as 10%, and it makes me think that the school committee should go back and consider a policy that also tries to maintain 10% in that account. But the challenge will be that we would need the entire tri-board to be supportive of keeping that account at 10% reserves of 10% of operating as well, because that account is actually depleting year after year after year. We're an important and big part of the townwide budget. Keeping that account safe and protected is also important to the town.
Wouldn't that put it around 750 or 700?
Yeah, that's what we've just
said. What is it now? What is your total budget for school choice? And then that would be 10% of that you would want to keep in it, right?
No, I think if we're saying 10% of operating, then we'd want to maintain about 750 in that account.
And what is it now? Or what will it go?
It's dipping below 600.
It'll dip below this year because we'll use well over $600,000. We offset more of operating costs this year. And our projected FY17, I think for this year, you probably have seen it more recently than I have, but I want to say that our receipts are less than we had in 16. I think our anticipated 16 receipts were 622, and I think our projected 17 receipts, you might be able to pull it updated, are 389.
Yikes.
I think they might be quite low. Off on that, school choice.
School choice, how much did you say?
I might be messing up my sending and receiving. What do you have for FY17? Are you on the
projected for the school choice would be somewhere in the neighborhood of 620,000.
620.
So I just, the projection, the 5-year projections we had is that account was going to continue to go until it was gone, and that isn't wise financial planning for the town as a whole. And so that the tri-board support of trying to find a way to maintain that balance so that the schools can take care of its own emergencies makes a lot of sense as we think of ourselves as one town and one budget.
I think a town has to worry about bigger blow-ups than a school does. I think we're looking at $1 million, and we have $2 million in our account, and we're looking at that for the 10% for ours. But what's a realistic number from the school's perspective? Because I don't think 750,000 is the number. I don't think it's 100,000 either, but there should be some number there that could be justified with some, I guess, research on it, and, you know.
Well, why don't we go back and come up and see if we can come up with a policy that's a little cleaner and clearer so that it's easy for everyone to understand, because right now it's something, our policy is something like that it is the same level as the number amount of grants we bring in, which changes all the time. So why don't we clean up our policy, come up with a number that is good, but then it will be important for the whole tribe board to support that along with us.
You could make it like almost like the free cash policy, a number that you don't want to dip below a certain amount of money.
I don't know why I thought it would work.
Well, it is, but if we haven't been able to follow that policy with the budgets in the last few years.
Well, I guess because we never want to deplete our budgets and kill our programs without knowing that there's some money sitting there. I think that's the whole problem with all of us looking at the budgets, that we know that that money's there, and you're going, well, how can I not do something when I know the money's there? You know, it's hurtful, you know, in some ways, you know.
Okay. All right, so we'll expect to hear more about that. And then next on the agenda, we have the revenue projection for 2018. So, David, it looks like based on this, we're looking at an overall projected revenue increase of about 2.3%.
2.8%, 2.3%. 2.3%, 2.28, that's what I meant to say earlier. If anybody wants to follow the information, there is a handout on the table. This information is available online at Board Docs at the Select Board's website, and you click on the Board Docs LT button. I'll give a moment for folks to get the information.
So, David, who was involved in coming up with the projection? Just you? So, did you run it by Dan Zadonik or?
I did not.
Linda or anybody? Okay.
No.
First draft.
Yes, first draft.
Okay. So let me just talk some of the numbers through, and then we can go back and look at this in a little bit more fine grain. You see the first table there, table one, property tax levy. And for the 2018 projected numbers, the first number is strictly formulaic. You add together the levy from the prior year, the new growth from the prior year, and the 2.5% increase of the prior year, and you receive this number, which is just a little bit over $10 million. And then you increase that by 2.5%. And then the new growth number is the base plus what I think we're going to be bringing in from the solar fields that are being constructed under the pilot agreements that we already have in place. So I'm thinking of new growth is going to be in the neighborhood of about $140,000. That's $50,000 less than current new growth. So that's a good conservative number. And then finally, the debt exclusion is a number that Linda provided for me from the treasurer's office. So net increase of property taxes of just shy of $400,000. The next table, table two, is state aid. And here I've been very conservative because I think that the legislature and the governor were over generous in an election year and found themselves in a bit of a financial bind, and so I'm not projecting any increase in state aid, with the sole exception of Chapter 70 education, and there I'm showing a 1% increase. I've been doing this for 21 years, and the legislature always likes to add money to Chapter 70. Table 3 is a longer list having to do with your local receipts. And there's a net increase of about $16,000. You'll notice that the motor vehicle is up by 40,000, but if you drift your eye down the page about halfway, the miscellaneous income drops by 44,000. That's because the Medicare D reimbursement is going away, so we're losing that money. That's a one-time loss.
Shouldn't the pilots be up higher with all the solar fields?
The pilot money goes into the new growth figure. There's
okay.
three different kinds of pilots. It's pilot and state aid, the solar field, and then the money that Amherst pays us for us to host their wastewater treatment plant. And then finally, table four are the enterprise receipts. I've kept them level funded in terms of the operating revenue because this is not part of the general fund. But the administrative charges to water and sewer, I increased those by 2% for water and 1% for sewer. And I held the administrative charges for HPAT even because we don't know where we're going with that. So that's where I think our revenue is coming up from for 2018. I've tried to be as conservative but realistic at the same time.
David, could you just ask about, so this is compared to the FY17 budgeted revenue?
Yes.
Are we tracking, we're 6 months through the year, are we tracking close to these figures now?
Right. So Justin and I had a conversation this morning about that very point. It looks like we're tracking well with where we expect to be through November. I'm looking for the December receipts, haven't come in yet. Mm-hmm. But we seem to be where we need to be. No surprises, no good surprises, no bad surprises at this point. Okay. We'll see a lot of our big money come in, particularly having to do with motor vehicle excise in February. Mm-hmm. So you'll see a lot of growth in the latter part of the year.
Our electrical inspector receipts, that number doesn't look right to me.
Where are we? We're down to
6,000.
That's a conservative number. It's based upon activity. I know he's doing a lot of work this year, but I don't think that number is based upon the growth that I expect through the solar fields. I think that's a safe number.
That's the last solar field coming in, right?
There are two coming in, and then there are two more planned.
Okay.
Are they on the
SREC
2 program or the SREC 3? They already got their SREC credits?
Yeah, so we got one that's already built under SREC 1. And another one's just been gone live in October under SREC 2. And the rest is all, we're maxed out in terms of our capacity to receive money out of those SREC programs. So it's only pilot agreements that we would be receiving money from.
So in terms of the budget process, what we've tried to do is have this conversation about revenues early now, so that as we get into the expense side of it, we're not arguing revenues anymore. We're clearly saying this is how much is available to cover the town's budget. And not a nickel more, not or less.
Keep our estimates.
Yeah, right. And these don't appear overly aggressive. So, in the past, we've wanted to get the tri-board's sign off on it. We're just saying it tonight. So, do you guys need to have further conversation about it, or
it's a projection?
Yeah.
And we follow it closely throughout the year to make sure that it follows our projections. Nobody wants to make a course change mid-year.
Right. This $20,000 for the police receipts, that's for the antenna?
That goes into the antenna receipts, go into the select board receipts.
Oh, so what's the $20,000 in police receipts?
It was the new traffic officer, enforcement officer. We're expecting to see more fines coming in.
Okay.
David, we voted on 2.5%. Can you just reiterate a little bit on that property tax levy of 4.52?
Right. Keeping in mind that the
202% is last year's
All right, so you take a look at the FY 2017 projected money. So the first line is 9,700,000 and change. The next one is 244,000, and then the next one is 194. You add those three together, you come up with a 10,157.
Okay. So any further discussion on the revenues? Are people comfortable moving forward with this?
I don't see anything that's particularly optimistic or overly zealous in being used for numbers here.
Yep.
I know that was a question last year.
You guys okay?
That's okay.
Yeah. All right. Do we need to vote on this, David, or?
No, it's only a
draft. Yeah, we're just using it for a projection, right?
Yeah, it's not a policy.
So it's just saying go forth with this number.
This is my best projection based upon the end of December.
Yeah.
Walk on the water.
I will. You know, the governor will be making his budget proposal. We'll hear about it at the MMA. So we'll certainly report back to the boards. each new information.
And the cherry sheets and how it goes.
Right.
I'm interested to find out if, because there was no tax holiday last year, if there's any issue or if it's supposed to be worth $25 million that weekend to the state.
Lottery income is down. Yeah. All that stuff is going to balance it.
Yeah, they're waiting for the casinos to come in to spend their money there.
18.
Okay, next on the agenda, discussion about the all boards meeting, which is currently scheduled for January 18th. So that would be 2 weeks from tonight.
Have all boards been notified regarding this meeting?
We had a long conversation at the department head meeting today, about this. They're looking for guidance from you as to what would be most helpful.
Right. But we also need to make sure planning board, conservation, yep, all those boards are notified as well.
Where's that meeting going to be?
I believe Hopkins.
Is it at what time?
I've checked their calendar. They don't have anything. The reservation has not been set. They don't have anything scheduled right now.
So tentatively Hopkins Academy. Roby?
Could you describe what the all-boards meeting is about?
Yes. So
what time?
That's why it's on.
I would assume 6:30, maybe.
We had 7, so that's why I was wondering.
Okay. Okay. Well, whatever you wrote down is probably right.
What time?
7.
So the all boards meeting, we did this for the first time last year, and the idea at that point was to get everybody in the room together at the same time so that people could get a better understanding of what types of challenges and issues were being faced throughout the town. The way that meeting went was that the select board kind of sat in the front and then people stood up, whether it was the Council on Aging or library trustees, and made brief presentations about, you know, again, what they were working on, what the challenges were, et cetera. And I think that was a good start, because we hadn't really done anything like that before. So the idea this year is part of the budget process and in the context of strategic planning would be to invite everyone together again, except rather than having people make presentations, that the select board would be able to articulate to everyone where we believe the priorities are going to be in the budget cycle, well, that the budget cycle will need to address this year. So that, you know, under the idea of having everybody rowing in the same direction, everybody's clear and knowing where time and money is going to be spent. And then it also gives people the opportunity to raise their hand and say, not so fast, I think you've really overlooked something, and we're, you know, maybe you need to be talking about something other than the fire department staffing, for example. So that's the general idea behind it. Okay, that's really information sharing.
Did anyone not say, I need more money?
Yes, actually, I mean, we don't have the budgets. The budgets are due
Monday.
But this is based on, it's really a continuation of the conversation that we had last year. So last year,
in the budget process, we, the select board at least, collectively agreed, and I think the finance committee concurred, that the police department needed a shot in the arm.
Right.
So that was the whole 49,000 or whatever that was actually, but, yeah, like 49,000 or so.
Something
about that, yeah. That wound up being voted at the fall town meeting.
By the way.
And then the SAFER grant for the fire department was still up in the air. And again, just at this table, the conversation last year was that we really wanted to focus on public safety and police department first, and then depending on how that went and depending what happened with the SAFER grant, that the likely logical next step is we've all been very concerned about the lack of staffing within the fire department, and that in this budget cycle, we would likely very much be focusing on figuring out how to come up with a full-time, daytime fire force. And I haven't heard anything different from anybody here over the past few months, so we all kind of nodded and said that that was definitely a collective priority, and was hoping that tonight we could talk about any other priorities that people feel may need to be addressed in the FY18 budget cycle.
We're hearing rumblings about CPA monies and ball fields getting accomplished and what can get done with that, so we'd love to hear from everybody in the same room where we're going with that. How is that, you know, progressing? What's going forward? Are there any shortcomings to it, or how can we help? Think things like that, or what everybody in the same room, the communication will help everybody understand where everybody's going with those things.
Amherst is in the same boat as us. If you read the paper, you know, they lost their SAFER grant.
Mm-hmm.
They've got Northampton over there with their ambulance bailing them out. It's going to be, you know, a big question for us, our ambulance service. They could pull the plug on us, you know, or if we sign a contract, they're obligated to us, but, you know, that's something that's going to be a big issue for the town of Hadley in the future, because they're stretched so thin now in Amherst. They probably could say, listen, I can't service Shutesbury and Leverett and Hadley anymore, you know. And so
I think another area that we talked about, and again, this was, you know, came out of the SWOT analyses, was kind of the pervasive issues. Talk about human resources, we've talked about information technology, we've talked about centralized purchasing. I mean, you know, we've talked about finance director. And I guess the question is, right now with the finance director, we're still waiting for the recommendation, the formal recommendation from the community compact folks, but that's imminent.
Yes, next 10 days.
Right, so we expect to hear more about that. But we also know that human resources, we had an
planning
awful...
board just talked about IT again last night.
Yeah, and it's, so those are issues that, I mean, if we're talking about improving the work environment for everybody and the quality of service to the residents of the town, it seems to me that we have to keep moving forward in some way on all of those fronts. So, you know, again, like John's saying, the planning board has IT issues. I mean, you know, so the more we can hear about that, but again, get collective agreement that as we go into the budget, if we're going to try to fund anything, those are the initiatives that we want to be pointing dollars towards.
And certainly seeing if we can group things together so that they
exactly.
share the expense and have, not have to do it all at once. So
mm-hmm.
makes sense to
establish
plan.
A queue so that you maintain a reasonable tax payment schedule.
Right. And then, you know, another thing I'd like to talk about too is obviously we're focused on expense right now, but on the revenue side, I think that there are a lot of things we can continue to do to try to promote economic development in town. And that really involves the planning board and you know, potential zoning changes and conservation, the permitting process, the inspections process.
Make sure your infrastructure is in shape for it.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah, and how that all, you know, again, if that's a mindset and we really want to be better at that, how can we all collectively work towards that? Good schools. People want to be in towns where they're good schools. Right?
We already have that.
And they want to
keep them
here.
That way.
And they move here for that purpose, for
yeah.
a good school choice.
Mm-hmm. So I think that the department heads and the you know, boards are going to be looking for some direction on what they should do on the 18th. So we just talked about a few things. Does anybody have anything else that they think's really should be front and center at that meeting?
Buildings Committee will want to be there.
Absolutely.
Some discussions with that. They hadn't been notified yet, though. When I talked to them last night, they hadn't received any information regarding that yet.
Okay.
So you're not expecting a formal presentation from each board or committee. It's more a response and reaction and discussion.
Right.
Okay.
So the first step in that is that tomorrow, based on whatever we're talking about right now, Jennifer and David would want to get out basically an agenda to everybody to say, based on the tri-board meeting last night, the select board has articulated the following areas of focus for the upcoming budget cycle. Let's everybody get in a room and talk about it. Is that the gist of it?
A small state of the union.
That's what everybody wants to know.
Especially with the support of air conditioners and ball fields and things like that getting done.
Yep.
Having CPA would be there.
They'll absolutely be there.
Yeah.
Before we conclude tonight, I imagine you want to say something regarding your warrant articles that's coming up on the 10th?
Vote yay.
Hope for the support of the community.
Yeah.
For which one?
Air conditioning units.
For everything.
For everything.
For everything.
Kumbaya.
Okay, so anything else about the all boards meeting?
No.
Okay, so are you guys comfortable with that, speaking that those are the areas of focus? Okay. All right, and then David, the last thing for tri-board is the annual town meeting.
So if the board could vote to open the warrant for the annual town meeting with the expected closure date of February 15th.
So moved.
We would be right on target.
Second.
We have prepared for you a preview draft warrant consisting of about 17 articles. There are copies available for the Finance Committee, for the audience.
I think
let's do it a lickety split. First three articles are standard articles.
David.
For grants for Chapter 90 and for short-term borrowing. These are always on the consent agendas.
It's going to change 15 times.
Article 14, 4 is the revolving funds.
Yep.
You have to vote those annually. Article 5 is our annual housekeeping article in order to transfer balances to where they're sitting unproductively. Article 6 is the omnibus budget, and we'll work on that for the next couple of months. Article 7 is a standard article. It's our water treatment plant filtration membrane reserve. We put $20,000 aside for that every year. Article 8 are three Municipal Modernization Act programs. Article 9 is the Long Range Plan Implementation Committee, taking action on that. Articles 10 and 11 are the solar pilots that I think are coming up. Article 12 has to do with the local option tax on recreational marijuana. Article 13 is the standard Community Preservation Act article. And then Article 14 is reserved for any CPA appropriation. Article 15 is a housekeeping article for the Planning Board. Article 16 is again related to recreational marijuana and zoning moratorium of 1 year. And then 17 is a reserve spot for the Planning Board. So that, in a nutshell, is what I think is coming up for the annual town meeting.
Okay.
There are some slam dunks in there. I won't ask you for votes tonight because you're just receiving the information. But I think at your next meeting, you can take 4 or 5 votes to recommend or not recommend, because these are standard housekeeping articles for the most part.
Okay.
In reserving the spot for the Planning Board, will that address the master plan they're working on too, possibly, or it's too early?
Yeah,
Too early for me to say, but it would be there for that purpose if they wanted to bring it forward at that time.
Okay, anything else for Tri-Board this evening? No? If not, then just a reminder for everybody, we'll probably say it again later in the meeting, January 10th, 12 to 8, polls are open.
Hopkins Academy.
Hopkins Academy. And if you have any questions at all about the articles, by all means, please call. There's a number on the insert, which is the town administrator's, the main line here, but there are people here at Town Hall who would be more than happy to answer any questions that you have. There is a lot of misinformation floating around, so I'm just encouraging everybody, don't necessarily assume that whatever your neighbor tells you is accurate, and if you want to make sure something doesn't seem quite right to you, then by all means, please ask.
The letter that was sent to everyone's home was very informative,
right,
and very clear.
So the key piece of information for people to know is that there's been a lot of confusion about the individual cost of each article.
Madam Chair, before we go further, I think we have a motion and a second on the floor. If we could get about the, if we could vote on that for the
open and close.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Apologize.
That's no. I'm glad you did that. Okay, motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Sorry.
So the no. Thank you. So the misinformation just has to do with there's some confusion about the cost of each article. People want to know if you're borrowing X amount, what does that amount mean on the tax rate for a particular item? So that information has been provided. But just a reminder, if you read the front page, the paragraphs on the other side of that sheet of paper, you'll note that we do have debt that is rolling off of the books. So indeed, the collective impact is $95. But if you're smart enough to go and add up each item, yes, indeed, it will add up to 236 or something like that. But that is not the impact on the tax bills because we have debt rolling off. Okay, so just to clarify that, but that amongst other questions have come up. Okay, so thank you, everybody. Okay, we'll conclude the tri-board and then we'll roll into our regular select board session.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Okay, so first item of business is the consent agenda. On the consent agenda this evening, we have minutes from December 14th. We have, I don't need to read all these warrants, do I?
No.
No, we have an awful lot of warrants to approve. so they're on the consent agenda. We have the request for a one-day liquor license from Wine and Canvas for January 14th. We have license renewals for the Hampshire Mall, 15XD, WAL Management, the Young Men's Club, River Drive Auto Body. We have a peddler's permit for Kim Otis Direct Energy Solar. We have the resignation for Richard Truswell from HPAT, which we'll talk about a little bit momentarily. And we have a new hire for the Water Division, and his name is Mark Forey.
I'd like to take Mr. Forey off, but I'd be willing to vote on the rest of them. I just want to talk a little more about Mr. Forey.
Okay.
Make a motion to accept the consent agenda.
Okay.
Second.
With the exception of that one. Mm-hmm. Okay. A motion made and seconded on the consent agenda. Any further discussion?
Except for the water.
Yeah. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So go ahead.
Marlo, if you could just tell us regarding a little bit regarding Mr. Forey for us, please.
Yes,
I was specifically impressed with his background and abilities that he's going to be bringing to the water department.
well, as indicated, he meets the requirements for the licenses we're looking for under the job description.
Already has them.
Operator in training. But he's also taken the next step and passed all the course of studies for his treatment three also, which was in part of the letter that I sent to the board. He has background in SCADA, adjusting water flows and chemical pump pacing. He was like a night watchman for West Springfield. So he's been in the water field for a little bit, but now it's time for him to move on and expand. So we interviewed three candidates, and he interviewed out real well, like I said, up and coming. He's missing his CDL and his oysters, but that's not as critical as the water licenses are going forward, especially under the sanitary survey that we just received, so.
Is there anything you can attribute the fact that we had better candidate, not better candidates, but we had a more interest in the position this time versus the last time when we were advertising for the position? I know when Guilford was here prior to it, he said, you know, you really got to work on developing your farm team so that when these job opportunities do open, there's people that are able to take these jobs. However, this time it seems as though that there was people that were more qualified that walked in the door with, you know, SCADA backgrounds and licenses or starter licenses, as John had pointed out. Why was that different this time versus the first time? Is there anything we can attribute that to?
I wasn't here the first time around, but I read some of the writings of the board meetings, but I really can't attribute that to anything. I was actually surprised we had the amount of candidates we had being around the holidays, so.
How many did you have?
Five total.
Three good ones.
Yes. Yeah. Others weren't licensed or so on and so forth.
That was my only asset, question regarding pulling that out. And I'd like to make a motion now that we hire, per the direction of the DPW director, Mr. Mark Forey, for the water division.
Second.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Abstain? Okay. Okay, and then I just wanted to take the opportunity now, did point out that Richard Truswell's resignation was part of the consent agenda this evening, and on behalf of the select board and the town, I just wanted to thank Richard for his many, many years of service here.
26
Richard,
years.
Pardon?
26 years.
His 26 years, thank you. I didn't have it in my head. I knew it was over 20. 26 years of service to the town of Hadley, and he's provided an invaluable service, and HPAT went from TV5 to 191, 192, whatever the stations are now.
193.
Thank you.
So often she works.
So, and more changes to come, which we're going to hear about this evening from our oversight committee. But again, thank you, Richard, for everything that you did for the town. Really appreciate it.
I'll second that, too. Thank you, Richard, very much.
Okay. All of us.
Okay. Public comment. Doesn't appear that there's anyone here for public comment. Okay, if not, we've got a few minutes before the 7:15 appointment, but any reason? Whoop, Marlo?
Just a quick note. I threw out at the staff meeting today. The final numbers for unaccounted for water are pumping figures. We're completed the end of December. And I just want to throw out the note that for the last quarter, we did about $76 million. But that equates back to 2012 figures for the amount of pumping. So we're in the realm of knocking the 31.4% unaccounted for back to somewhere around 13-15%. We don't have exact accurate numbers, but I think all the repairs, the leaks we found, has really done us well. So that's a good thing.
Nice. It's a very good thing. Yeah, thank you.
What does that equate to in savings? I mean, if we were to back up to it, obviously pumps are running less, but I mean, does that mean our pumps are running 10% less, 12% less?
It's hard to say.
We're not cutting your budget tonight. I just am trying to get a feel for it.
I think that more equates to, it's hard to tell because we had probably the driest season we've had in forever, probably. So I don't really know what that equates to, but I do know that if we only pumped that in the fourth quarter back of 2012, which was a much wetter fall season, I think we're in really good shape as far as losing unfinished water, unaccountable water. But I can't put a figure exactly to that. I can get that for you.
Okay. Thanks, Marla. Okay, so we have our 7:15 appointment here with the Hadley Public Access Television Oversight Committee. So thanks for coming back. Thanks for staying the course. And you have an update for us and a request, I think.
Sure. We could start. Elsie isn't here with us today, but for unforeseen circumstances, she couldn't make it. But on behalf of all of us, we also want to thank Richard for his several years of devotion and service to HPAT. We really appreciate that as well. Going forward, we do have a request that we might be called the PEG Governing Authority in Hadley. I think you have it in front of you. Thank you. To just give you a little outline, I'm sure you've already read that, so I don't want to take any more of your time, but this committee is now the Oversight Committee. It came from Advisory to Oversight, and we're to now, again, just step it up a bit to oversee the operations of the station and kind of take it all off of you and put it on us. Of course, it will still follow the chain of commands as well, which would be, as you know, you would be the final, but we really want to be able to have a little more in-house authority for this said station. And again, that would be called the PEG Governing Authority in Hadley. We have found that many other stations have this, and it helps with the collaboration of other stations and so forth if we actually have that name along with the licensing and so forth. That having been said, we can do things like suggest to you a person that would step in at HPAT. And that having been said, we could talk a little further about that, but I just wanted to open it up first to ask any questions or if you have any questions on that request.
Okay. So moved.
Anybody have any questions on the contents of the letter? Seems fairly boilerplate. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, well, we should probably make a form. Not probably,
said,
we should make
a form.
I
said,
you did? You moved it?
I moved it.
Thank you. It's a soft voice you're carrying this
I
evening. Okay, motion made and seconded to approve. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Abstain? Okay. Okay.
Okay,
so we will
so
get that signed
that.
This evening, too.
Thank you. Some hard work has gone into that, and we have hard work in the future. But going forward, we'd like to hope to introduce Drew Hutchinson, who's behind the camera today.
You can feel to step out in front and wave if you like.
There he is. He's behind the camera. But anyway, he
just don't choke on the wires.
Right. Well, we're hoping that he may come out another day when
okay.
It's a little more convenient. But he's doing such a great job behind the camera, figuring it out. Ad hoc. So here's the thing. We're going to hope that he comes in as a consultant for us. To just slip in as a station manager is a little difficult, given that we don't know what we don't know yet. And that's why we are hoping to have Drew come on as a consultant for our station for at least the rest of this fiscal year. And we'll certainly come back to you accordingly with reports on how we do. And I will mention that Richard's been a great help to Drew as well in this transition. And we appreciate that as well. But that having been said, you'll hear some fantastic ideas that come forward with Drew. We're hoping that he gives us an outline for this station so that we can see some really amazing changes and some fun additions to an already great station.
I'd like to have you been checking out Drew's references. Drew, I would love it if you would step around just to wave to the people just for 3 seconds.
Part of the team.
And we're working entirely within the existing budget. There's no new money involved here. So we're just...
Oh. Nope, they can't
yes.
see you.
Yes,
no,
delayed.
Delayed.
Okay. Oh.
All
right.
Can't see ahead, but that's all right.
No headshot.
Okay, well, you know what?
It's okay. Another day. Okay.
Thank you. So Drew's jumped in here and has been donating a lot of hours. So just letting you guys know that we're working within the budget we have. No new money is needed so far. We have checked out 4 of his references now. We'll talk with David about that. So everything's looking very good. Thank you for your support.
Does he have some type of background in communication
yes,
and stuff? And, you know,
yes.
Just could you hit on that a little bit? Or you want to wait?
No, we're happy to pass along the resume.
Yeah.
I have an anecdote. I called 3 of the references myself. And the first guy I called was the guy who runs all the servers for UMass. And before I could get much out of my mouth, he said, is this about Drew Hutchinson? And I said, yes. And he said, if you hire him, he'll be the best hire you will ever make. And I have been checking references for 40 years. This is the first time I ever heard anything like this.
My second call was to the guy that runs educational technology at Greenfield Community College, who's been there for a very long time and consultant in the region. And he said, I wish I could hire him. So, we pushed a little farther than just that. But so far, everything's looking really good.
So
and we'll pass along the resume. And the
are you also considering rewriting the job description, too?
Absolutely.
That's why he's hired as a consultant. Because, as Kathy said, we don't know what we don't know. Mm-hmm. And when we discussed this with the town accountant, we were sort of tentatively asking him if it was any problem with hiring him as a consultant. He said, are you kidding? That's what I do. Mm-hmm. I'm doing the same work that the town accountant was for the same pay, but you don't have all the overhead associated with a paid employee. And we're very fortunate that Drew is willing to work on this basis for us.
And I'll wrap up, if I may, by saying that Drew has a big background over 10 years of doing local programming.
Oh, great.
Something we haven't been so strong on here. So all of you should be thinking about what kind of little shows or interviews or documentaries we could be doing locally.
Yeah, just to say, from teaching, he's been a teacher at Greenfield, and he has his own called Local Bias. You can look it up on your
GCTV.org.
Thank you, GCTV.org. And it's a Local Bias, and he's also been a teacher for the in
Franklin Tech.
No, for Greenfield.
Greenfield High School part-time film teacher.
A film teacher, so.
Do you have a commitment on the total hours that he would commit
at this point? It's a consultancy, not an hourly job.
Yeah. Still work out about
and
the same.
And we will work out all of the, yes.
The details will work out the same. Okay, yeah. Fine.
And we'll come up with the business structure.
Great.
He will help us all with that, so we really appreciate it.
Marlon, did you want to say something?
Sure. I think if you need another reference, my daughter would be more than happy to speak.
Oh, she was a student.
Yeah,
tell us the story.
She loved this class. So,
oh, great.
Kelsey.
Oh, yeah. I thought you looked familiar.
Well, perfect. There you go.
Okay, thank you, guys. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Sure. So anything else we can do for you this evening? Are you're good to go?
I can use it.
We have a meeting Friday, and I
think let me talk outside
about that. Yeah, so I think at this point we're good. We will definitely check in with you. I think we have some.
Did we need to sign something? There was a.
Yes. Jennifer has it over here.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. David, you wanted to?
Yes, David.
Yeah, just want to check in on a couple of things. Did we want to take a formal vote on activating the third PEG channel?
I don't think necessary.
There's an issue with that. Richard mentioned that. That is dedicated to the fire and police in the contract right now. I haven't looked into the contract to know that that is true or not. And quite frankly, you have almost no original content on HPAT 1 or HPAT 2 other than these meetings. So why use a third channel if it's not necessary? In fact, I was thinking maybe getting a feed from either Northampton or Amherst would be something that would benefit the community of Hadley. Okay. If you do have the ability to use it that way, and then the fire and police can override it if they need to.
Mm-hmm. Right. I just wanted to follow up on that because that was a request.
Well,
that
I wonder if we just get it. Should we get the votes in order when it comes, if it comes in your outline that we need it, we'll have it? We don't have to do it. It doesn't mean we have to do it right away. It just means they're saying it's okay to do it if we need it.
Far be it from me to understand the intricacies of policy like this.
I mean, the board meets frequently enough that when you need it, they can take the vote.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Yeah.
You know.
And just a reminder, we do have an all-boards meeting on January 18th at Hopkins Academy. So if...
we won't be here, we'll be over there. So.
Yeah, and we'll get that outline from you as Park and Rec, too. I would like to know what we're going to address. So.
Okay.
We'll be ready for that along with HPAT as well.
David?
We were actually looking at maybe getting a school involved in that third channel at some point, too, along with the police and fire, or maybe one of the two that we're using now. You know.
The superintendent.
There was a lot of ideas that we were throwing around.
I exchanged emails with the superintendent tonight, and we're going to have further discussions, because certainly the seniors at the Senior Center are right there. Yeah. They're a great resource. The students at Hopkins Academy are a great resource.
Yeah.
Anyone who loves Hadley is a great resource. Right. So it's time to change direction a little bit, I think, and get more community involvement.
Mm-hmm. Rah-rah.
And just looking at your existing budget, it looks like most of the budget is in a personnel line. And if we're working with Drew as a vendor, we may want to look at how we make that happen for the rest of the fiscal year.
Mm-hmm.
I have some ideas as to how to skin that particular cat, but I'd like to talk it over with you.
What did you mean?
Okay, so you have this salary line where you spend money, and there are benefits and deductions that are taken out of it. If you spend that on a vendor, then you get into some difficulty.
We've already been through this with the town accountant.
Okay, with Joan and all that?
With the town accountant and the treasurer.
Okay. All right, so I'll be happy to work with you then.
Yeah.
And if we need to do a cleanup article at the annual town meeting, we'll have plenty of time to figure it out.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Perfect. Thanks a
lot.
Nice
to meet you, Drew.
Thank you.
You okay?
Welcome, Drew.
I'm good.
Okay.
Okay, so moving into old business, we
you
have...
You're going to leave them alone here with us?
I know, we said
we've checked his background, Corey. He's been fingerprinted.
I think you're safe, John.
Happy New Year, guys.
Happy New Year.
Take care.
Okay, so we have Gooseberry Lane Notice of Layout as a public way. So we have a recommendation from the Planning Board. I believe that they did just vote. To accept Gooseberry Lane, they're recommending we do the same and set the date, time, and location of the layout hearing.
Right. So I have to give everybody on Gooseberry Lane 7 days written notice. So if we could be thinking about a time sometime after the all boards meeting, that would be helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
When's the next meeting? After the
18th? Is this the walking?
This would be the walking one.
This is the walking of the way. Yeah. So anybody in particular want to walk Gooseberry Lane?
When is that?
That's what we're talking about.
Oh. Well, I don't get out of work till 5, so I'm not sure what you want to do.
David,
do
you typically want to do that during the work day?
Last time we did it prior to a select board meeting, and I think we started around 3 o'clock in the afternoon and ended up at 5, but we were doing two roads that were...
That was Lorana and Holly, because I did
Holly,
that.
Yeah.
I'm more than happy to share.
How many people need to be involved?
Just one, really.
Just one.
Yeah. I'm pretty flexible.
Yeah, I mean, I know what the road looks like anyways.
Okay.
I can certainly drive down it. That's not an issue.
No, this is you actually have to walk
but we have
it.
But we have to give the residents there an opportunity to know that we're there.
So.
Some arcane.
So how about prior to not the meeting on the 18th, but the following meeting,
the
20th. That's available.
So do
are you scheduled to be here on the 25th?
Well, it would be
make it snow.
The walk is, but if we need him to be.
Oh.
Yeah, snow and you look at the page.
Okay, so tentatively the 25th then?
Okay. We'll
Jerry?
Set it up.
Available.
You're a good soul.
What was the time?
What time?
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. And who's representing the board?
I will be happy to join.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Next, we have a discussion about snow removal on private ways.
So, I see we have an article.
Question one.
Well, okay, so.
Did that in 2008.
A little bit of background there. So, when I first came to the town, we would make calls about snow. I'd let everybody know whether we had a two-hour delay or if town meeting, town hall was closed or going to let out early. But I'd also call up private developers and say, you need to go out and plow your roads. This was not a successful exercise, and we had difficulty getting private developers to plow their roads in a timely fashion. In 2007, I believe, we had a near emergency with somebody on Birch Meadow Drive. There was a gas leak, and it leaked into the home, and somebody became overcome by the fumes, and the road had not been plowed, and the ambulance had a very difficult time getting in and rescuing the person. Everybody's fine. All right, but it gave us an opportunity to reassess private drives from a public safety perspective. The select board at that time asked that this be a ballot vote in April 2008. The question was posed to the voters whether we adopt Mass General Law Chapter 44, Section 6, I believe it is, which allows us to choose, if we wish, to appropriate money to plow private drives without incurring liability. That was passed by the voters. The vote was 564-4 and 437 against. So we started plowing roads, and for the for about 5-6 roads, is it? Is that the number of roads that we do?
Less now.
Fewer now.
Because
we adopted twice.
Yeah.
Nine.
There are nine.
That were plowing out. There was 11. Two of them just got accepted.
We did minimal plowing just for the purposes of getting police, fire, ambulance down these roads so that people would be safe in the town.
What are they?
Holly Road just got accepted. Honey Pot Road. Laurel Drive just got accepted. Red Smith's Road, Bayberry Lane, Gooseberry Lane, which we're talking about, Birch Meadow Road, Nikki's Way, Crystal Lane, Megan's Way, and Indian Pipe.
They're still not accepted?
To my knowledge, everything I've dug into, these nine have not been accepted, except we're in the process of Gooseberry.
Megan's brand new, Indian Pipe two houses out.
Yeah, those three, Nikki's Way, Crystal Lane, and Megan's Way, particularly two of them, I received a phone call on this summer saying we needed to plow them, so.
So the Select Board and the Planning Board got together and decided that we were going to move these projects forward and do them as, accept them as public ways. We started out with Holly Road and Laurel Drive, and now we're looking at Gooseberry, and so some of these others will be brought forward as they become ready for acceptance. The problems began this winter with a developer coming in and pretty much insisting that we plow a road which basically is still under construction. The final top coat hasn't been put down, and the houses haven't been developed in total. And we were given the go-ahead to plow these roads for the time being, but with the understanding is that we would bring this back for the board for a reassessment.
I think the last two, they were top coated, the pavement was done, but I think what triggered my thinking on this and wanting to talk to the board and get the history and understand going forward is the process of, I'm not here for or against the plow of private ways. I want to try and establish a protocol or a direction. Rather than somebody calling me or walking in my office and telling me I need to plow a road. I mean, I have concerns for our drivers and the welfare of the town of accepting a road, at least to inspect it. Working with the planning board beforehand, if we have raised basins or there's things we can damage our vehicles on, or particularly possibly get a driver hurt, you know, with no prior knowledge of looking at the road or anything and just going and plowing it. I mean, I'm looking for steps.
You're looking at private ways that eventually are going to become public ways. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes. Not private ways that have been private ways and always will be private ways.
Yes, there's a lot of other private ways out there.
Yes.
I didn't bring that list.
Yes.
But this is I can see, and there's houses on these developments that are needing to be plowed?
Yes, I think in particular, I think it's Megan's Way or one of the newest ones that's got one house now on it.
And I think somewhere it should fall along the lines because of these other roads that we've accepted that are even not, at least they're blacktopped.
Yeah.
And they're finished. And they've been approved by the planning board, but they haven't been taken by the town as public ways yet. Whereas these other developers haven't really developed their property. They've only put one house or two houses and have left it open and not finished the roadways. And so, I mean, it makes a difference. If they were to go in and finish the roadways and then put the houses up, that would be a different story.
Yes.
But I don't think that qualifies as...
There's another one that was just completed that doesn't even have a house on it over there on 47 South.
You don't plow that, do you?
No.
But there's not a house on it yet. But that road hasn't been accepted, but it's built to be.
Finished coat on top?
But there is a finished coat on it.
Water line already installed?
Yeah.
But there's not a house on it.
No.
Right. So... We brought Chief Mason and Chief Spangnable into the discussion ahead of time before tonight's meeting, and we added all these ideas around. And absolutely, it's about public safety and everything. As I indicated to both chiefs, you get an emergency in the middle of the night, we'll drive a 3/4 mile of gravel driveway to get you there.
Yeah.
I'm not worried about it.
But the developer, I think the developer has a responsibility to these people that he's selling the property and the houses to that. knowing that they're not roadways, it's his responsibility at this point until he finishes the roadways to put a blacktop on there.
I'm mostly concerned about the heights of the structures for the catch basins, et cetera. That's what I don't want our trucks. That's what I want our trucks picking up.
The thing over the last 30 years since before police, fire, and yourself have gotten here, if there was an emergency and a big storm and whatever big truck was in the area that was able to get down that road to get the person in an ambulance or the fire truck in, we always did it. There's somebody there in the storm.
And that holds true for probably just about every community.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't an issue of the public safety part of it. It's just a responsibility of the property owner until the road got accepted. Is really what we're talking about now at this point.
Doesn't the planning board have regulations on selling houses before the road is completed?
Yes, they do.
They do when they're addressing this. This has been ongoing for 4 years I've been here.
But many developments are completed, Birch Meadows, et cetera, like Gooseberry, that are completed, and they never petitioned to the town to take the road over.
Yeah, and that's what we're doing now. But now, I thought you're referring to ones that are currently being built, that they're selling lots, and the road is inadequate to plow.
Yes.
No. The pavements have been put in place. But what happens is when that pavement gets put in place, in particular what happened this fall was a developer coming into my office and saying, you're plowing these two roads and walking out the door, similar to that fashion. But there's nothing in between. You know, there's going to be some sort of, they're not accepted roads, I guess is what I'm saying. Town accepted roads are still private ways. I'm not against plowing them, but I don't want to go in and plow something that's not completed as far as road surface structures and stuff like that. So I'm trying to create possibly a connection with planning, the select board, and myself when this comes before us again. I just don't go out there and plow the first storm and don't know what we're getting into out there.
Hasn't it been the policy of the board to plow the roads once we start collecting taxes from these houses?
Wasn't the policy?
No, it's never been?
No.
And I would think the roads would have to be adequate then to plow them.
Some feedback from planning board. And do you have a copy of this section 6C?
I think there should be a copy of that as part of your material. Apparently not.
No.
But, okay.
I mean, it's pretty clear that if we damage something on any of these private ways, we're not liable for repairing it, such as a catch basin sticking up or something like that. But my concern was more in reverse if these things aren't adequate. A good example is trees growing into the roadway and waving mirrors out in plow trucks. You know, at what point do we say we're not coming in there until you trim your trees? Stuff like that. I'm trying to look out for the town's vehicles and damage to that as well.
So we actually came up with with some recommendations. Marlo, here's a copy of the law that you were asking for. You know, our recommendation is that we work with the planning board in order to develop a process by which developers who have active construction sites, which these subdivisions are, that they get in place some sort of maintenance bond or some sort of maintenance agreement so that this is not a future problem. We're just going to be cleaning up what problem we have right now.
Yeah, I was under the impression that the planning board was involved in something like that. Now, at this time, after what we went through with the last couple of roads.
Right.
I don't know if the planning board wants to be involved with this. I mean, we're talking about a road that has catch basins that are up. I mean, isn't that our purview and our determination to make sure that?
No, because they've got the site plan approval and all of that.
When it's done. Well, when it's done, I have no problem at all. I have a problem with dropping a plow truck on a road where catch basins are up. And I don't want to do any plowing on any of those roads until I get a sign off from the owner of the development that says, you know, here's the deal. If we plow the road, any damages to the truck or any damages to the road are going to be his responsibility. As a catch basement, they're high. Now, if you talk about roads like Gooseberry where the catch basins and the final tar job is done, I absolutely agree with you.
No, And what I'm trying to say, Jerry, is if the planning board pushes this through so it gets accepted in a timely manner and the road is finished, then we're not going to run into these kind of glitches.
David, why did you want to involve the planning board?
So for two reasons. First of all, is that in future subdivisions that we have the proper maintenance agreements in place so that the developer cannot come into your office and say, it's your problem now and I'm going to continue building houses while you're out there plowing my road.
And we would be sending to the planning board an outline of procedure as to how this would be progressing, regardless.
Yeah.
So, from the first day that they walk in there with subdivision plans, that they understand right out the giddy up that this is what's going to be done and this is how it's going to go forward.
Right. And then the second reason for working with the planning board is to take these old subdivisions where the road has not been accepted and continue your program of making them public roads. So that we do two or three every year.
That makes sense to me.
And I think that's following the will of the people from the vote.
I think that's the way we were going,
We also talked about the safety of the road crews and that at the beginning of the winter we inspect these private drives and if they are unsafe for whatever reason that we're going to be losing trucks or hurting human beings, is that we have the right to say no, we're not going to do this.
It triggered the thought that whether I get a phone call or somebody comes in my office and say you're doing this new road X and Y this year, the final coat's on, in my opinion it should trigger some sort of interaction with the board, an inspection process that, hey, you know, we have the right to not plow it if it's dangerous, faulty construction, or obstacles in the way. You know, a simple inspection and bringing it to the board's attention that, hey, this road's okay, we can do it. It's still a private way, but we can maintain it for public safety. That was the little gap that jumped out to me right out of the gate, and it triggered this conversation with the four of us. To bring it before you tonight.
So I'm fine with the proposal you've come up with. Just get together with the planning board, work out a process, stop the bleeding going forward. And
that's fine.
What do we do with existing road that has raised catch basins?
We don't go in.
I don't go in.
That's what I was saying, the right not to plow if dangerous or not faulty construction or there's obstacles.
Boy, are those roads up there? Don't have a final payment?
No, they got the final code on.
All of them?
Yes. But it triggered the question of how do we know it's up to what the planning board agreed to do before we go in and plow it? I have a phone call or somebody walking in my office and that's it. With no inspection, no other protocol to bring before you, or I should bring before you that, hey, it's a private road, but, you know, yeah, I'm okay with it. The DPW is okay with it. We'll take over the plowing and
That's just what the planning board was talking about last night.
Yeah.
Back to IT, you know, if the planning board could contact the DPW and the building inspector and everybody get together on one page,
shared
everybody
thoughts.
Would know what was going on here, you know? And,
so, I mean, I'm not here to, you know, waste a lot of your time tonight, but to me, it's kind of a little bit of an issue on our end to look out for our drivers and our equipment, too.
Yeah. So I don't think you need a vote, right? So you just, that's the plan.
I think that's the plan, but I think if we're going to refuse to, if we know that by looking at the road we're not going to plow it, we need to notify the people on the road and the developer that,
of course,
that this is the case. If there's some sort of obstacle in the way, such as a derelict vehicle, I'm not saying that's going to happen, but just in case there is, we obviously deal with that on as a case-by-case basis.
Well, and that's an important point I didn't think about with winter parking ban. It's a private road, and if they're in our way, we back out and leave, and we can't have the police department tow on private property. That's another thing that just came to mind. So we would have to back out and say, we can't get through or whatever.
Plowmen, just like you were in New York City.
That's right. Good customer service in the DPW, Jerry.
There you go.
Okay, all right, so we all set with this discussion then?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, sounds good. Thanks, Marlo.
Thank you.
Public records compliance plan, David.
Happy New Year. January 1st, the new public records law took effect. Every city and town, every state agency, every school district, every housing authority, every water district Now, as you know, under the new rules require that each political subdivision have a records access officer. You've seen a draft of this plan. You've asked for revisions. We took those revisions into account. The final regulations by the Secretary of the Commonwealth were promulgated on December 16th. We've reviewed those regulations and made further adjustments. And now we have a compliance plan, which we think adheres to the law in as many respects as we can anticipate. This is a new law. There's some ambiguities. There's some ambiguities to it, and so I think that as case law occurs and as the Secretary of the Commonwealth tightens up their regulations, we're going to be revisiting this compliance plan in April, most likely. But my recommendation at this point is that we've made the changes that you've requested, and we've made the changes based upon the latest and greatest information and in consultation with counsel. And I ask that you support the compliance plan.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Okay. If not, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Thank you.
How many pages for this?
Eight.
Can we just leave a few copies available at the town hall for anybody?
Right. And we'll definitely make this available by July 2017. We have to post this on our website. So
we're gonna
get a 6-month jump on this,
yeah,
and get it out there.
Okay. Next order of business, the town administrator contract. So in executive session, we had discussion and took a vote at our last regularly scheduled meeting in December. And in accordance with open meeting law, what we need to do now is take a public vote on whether or not we are going to renew David Nixon's contract as town administrator. And then we'll be signing it today as well, if that's the will of the board. Okay, so does this need to be a roll call or just a straight? Okay. So this is a 3-year contract. I think it'd be starting at an annual base pay, July 2017, $91,940. And I think that's a 2% increase for each year thereafter. There were some minor modifications made having to do with notice requirements, et cetera, but that is the gist of the contract. So all in favor of approving the renewal for David Nixon to continue as town administrator for the next 3 years, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
And any abstentions?
Yeah, I'm going to abstain at this time.
Okay. So 3-1-1. Well,
congratulations,
thank
David.
You very much.
I don't know if I should say congratulations or not, but
thank you very much. I appreciate it. Look forward to working productively with the board for another 3 years and making sure that the town of Hadley moves forward in a positive direction.
I'm
excellent.
Sure you will, David. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll get that signed tonight. Yeah. Okay. Water and sewer. Oh, I'm sorry, Marlo. I probably should have taken this before.
He wasn't in any hurry tonight.
Yeah, he's just hanging out.
We've got to open that door, though. At least one of them.
Would you open the door, Marlon?
Yeah.
Not for air, but the state would be on us. Closed meeting.
Okay, David, you want to cue this up?
So, the Select Board assigned the DPW Director and the Town Administrator to review sewer and water rates and present information to tonight's meeting. Just a little bit of background, the Select Board last changed their water rates back in 2007.
9 years ago.
Yes. It was at that time, I think it was a 3.5% increase. And the idea back in 2007 is that we would increase water rates in order to cover the new debt for the Callahan Water Treatment Plant. That was the new project that was coming online. And that we would hold the rates steady for a three-year period, and then revisit those rates on an annual basis. Back in 2009, in anticipation of that rate change in 2010, we did a rate study, which you have a copy of, which made a recommendation to raise the rates in order to account for rising costs at that time. That study was not implemented, and no further rate changes were made since 2007. In 2008, the independent, at that time, an independent sewer commission raised the sewer rates by 4.5% to cover expected operational and capital expenses. And again, those rates have remained unchanged since 2008. We have a situation where we have been watching the revenues come in at a fairly steady pace, but our expenses have increased in the normal way that they do, as well as we recognize that we need new capital improvement of the infrastructure, and that's going to result in debt service that we have not adjusted the rates for. So in 2007, the Massachusetts Department of Revenue was invited to conduct a management review of both the sewer department and the highway and water departments, and at that time they recommended that we should review annually our rates and our expenses to make sure that everything is coming in where they need to be. They made a recommendation that we should tier the sewer rates, which they've done in part as a result of that recommendation, but there's more that can be done. They also recommended that we bill for water and sewer quarterly, which back in 2007 we were not able to do because of the state of the water meter at that time and the amount of time it took for us to read those meters. And at that time, it took about 3 months for us to do a reading, and quarterly was just not going to work for us. We've gone through a major upgrade of most of the water meters in town. I think there are about 200 still left that need to be upgraded, but now they're on radio reads. You could just drive down the street and we can do the complete water read in about a week, week and a half. So now we're in a position where we can do quarterly billing. And then to establish enterprise reserve policies, which we adopted both for sewer and water at that time. Looking forward into the future and looking at the kinds of regulations that the US EPA and the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection is expected to levy on us for water use in particular, that water conservation is going to be very important, and looking at our overall water pumping license is going to be something that we can expect in the next 5 years. And so efforts to conserve water and reduce the amount that we pump overall is going to be very important for the regulatory agencies that pretty much tell us how we should run our operation. We also want to make sure that we have servant solvency. So these are considerations for a new rate structures, water conservation, service solvency. We certainly want the rates to support ongoing operations. Reserves, we want to make sure that we have adequate reserves for each of the water and sewer enterprise funds, which we have plenty of, but we could do better. We want to make sure that the new rate structure covers our capital projects. And we want to move on to quarterly billing. So I think those are, and then finally, we want to make sure that whatever rate structure that or rate changes that we implement, that we do it in such a way that it's fair and affordable. So that's what we have in front of you at this point.
So what are you looking for from us this evening? Agreement in principle that we explore this?
Right. So we had a meeting with DPW and all the people associated with the administration of DPW and myself, as well as a member of the financial management team. We started playing around with numbers, and we think that we know that we are here and we need to be here, but we can't get there in 1 year. This is going to be a multi-year approach. So I've asked for suggested numbers for the for water and for sewer. I've asked for a review of the tiered structure for water and a further review of the semi-tiered structure for the sewer in order to make sure that the model that we had in place back in 2007 makes sense for the 21st century. Marlo, do you have any of those numbers of, at this time? I think you were working with Sharon about on them.
As far as what, which numbers?
Just, I think if we make some adjustments, we can easily see our revenues increase by $60,000 without a lot of pain to the people. I also think that we can add some tiers in order to take the high-end users and make them look into ways to conserve water. There are some houses, their irrigation systems use so much water that you can supply a neighborhood. And when I say a neighborhood, it's 8 houses worth of water is used to supply some people's lawn irrigation systems. So I think we need to be looking at a higher rate for that kind of water use.
I actually have 3 or 4 breakdowns of different scenarios, but we were particularly looking at that 65 figure. Mm-hmm. So a uniform rate increase of 25 cents would give us additional revenue of $65,000 under the water rates. I have some other values here. Uniform percentage increase of 11% to all rates would generate $105,114 per year.
So this does not have to go to town meeting, correct?
Correct.
Because we're the commissioners.
That's right.
And remind me of the time, isn't, I know there's an incredible lag between when a rate increase is voted and when it's actually felt.
Right.
So what's...
Collected, yeah.
Yeah.
So if you made a decision by April 2017, the ratepayers wouldn't see that increase until August 2017. So you're talking about 3 or 4 month lag there, assuming that you're still on semi-annual billing.
Correct. Yeah, quarterly billing will back that up.
Right. So really, basically, I've been saying it for 4 years. If we had gone up 1% for 4 years I've been here. Mm-hmm. We're looking at 9 years, it would have been 9%, which is pretty accurate with his 11% increase right there. That you all ignored all the time.
Every time I try to say something, you don't want to listen to me.
But you can't, people in town don't want their taxes to keep going up when there hasn't been a need for it.
There obviously is a need for it if you read the
They don't think so when they see your reserve fund, John.
If you're not testing those Mount Warner wells, which you're going to need because we are already on water restrictions with the Bay Road wells, there's an option there to probably look into putting a treatment plant up at Mount Warner at some point, and they wanted to close those wells. You're not going to just drill another well when you need it.
So
those are there and active, and we have them.
I'm certainly in favor. I don't think we're doing anybody a favor when that much time goes by and people are looking at, you know, a significant jump. I think it's appropriate that if we're going to look at it, it's in a phased in
I think
approach.
It should be phased in also, yes.
Yep, so I'm amenable to hearing more formal proposal from you.
Okay.
How does everybody,
Absolutely.
I think John, I think I know how you feel. Donald, you comfortable with that?
Yeah, I'm fine with it. I really like the quarterly billing.
Me too.
We would have eliminated a lot of our abatement problems with people coming in because they would have spotted it earlier.
Right.
Instead of waiting 6 months before they get a bill. So.
And it's better for budgeting, household budgeting.
Budgeting, as I talked about earlier in the public speaking part of the meeting, unaccounted for water, that's huge. If you look at the pumping figures that I brought, it was like, there was this big gap of pumping phenomenal amount of water before we really even knew if it was unaccounted for water. You bring that gap back 4 months if you got something going on out there.
Mm-hmm.
There's many advantages to it.
Not to change the subject, is there any update on the water ban situation from the state?
We removed the ban.
Okay, I wasn't even aware
right
of that.
Around Christmas.
Okay, so that's why it's fairly recent then. Okay.
I felt it was the right thing to do going through winter, and we'll see where we're at, where DEP and EPA say we're at come spring. And rather than keep it on through the whole winter and everybody become desensitized to it, then we'll go off it for the winter. And then obviously we're going to have to, you know, revisit it for stormwater warning come spring. But
the state still has theirs in effect for certain areas, though they didn't remove it for everyone, right?
I mean, we're technically,
you can do it individually by towns, right?
Yes, yeah, we can after a certain date. I want to say it's September 15th. Don't hold me to it. October 15th, something like that. You are allowed to go off the ban we were on with no consequences. So I elected. We were getting much more rain. We're a lot better off. Obviously, we don't have crops going. It only made sense to get off this thing for the winter and revisit in the spring to see where everyone else is at with the drought monitor, so to speak.
The collector asked that y'all know that, can you let David know the decision needs to be made by April only if we are going to go to quarterly? Otherwise, the change wouldn't be effective until February 18th.
Let's take a vote tonight at least to change
to
that
quarterly.
Pass
sure.
of it, and I'll make a motion to go to quarterly water tax bills.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. All in favor?
Water and sewer?
Water and
both,
sewer.
Yeah.
Both, yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Yeah. I might want to add that the sanitary survey highly recommended that too,
mm-hmm.
the quarterly billing. So
yep.
I may have already said that. It's been one day.
Okay.
So. And I'm interested in, you know, raising rates also, but not in such a way that it would be not nice, let's put it like that. Let's do it in increments.
As we talk about, it's been such a length of time.
Right.
Operating expenses are quickly starting to match the revenues. So certainly we need to visit that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, thanks, Margo. Okay. So we'll expect to hear more about that.
Are we testing those wells in Mount Warner quarterly or not?
Yes.
Okay. It says here, if it's not being tested within 5 years from DEP, then we can't use it.
Correct. We are. I just started gathering information today, John, for that high pump test up there. I'm a well driller. It's just starting, as well as many other projects. As I said in the staff meeting today, I think all of the things are there. A lot of stuff that came out in the sanitary survey, we got ahead of the curve on it. We have the funds for some of this.
Yeah.
The rate study is another thing we don't have funds for every year. But again, we can make that part of this water sewer rate thing and decide what we want to do with the rate study because they're recommending that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those wells in the past are pumping a couple million gallons a day, you know?
Yeah.
And if it's feasible to look into a treatment plant up there for chloride, I mean, why wouldn't we think about that, you know?
You know, the thing is, too, is if this was a plume, we don't know. That's why we have to do the test. And DEP doesn't like wells just sitting out there.
Yeah,
you either
got to
use them
it.
Or you get rid of them, and no one likes to get rid of wells.
No, you're not going to drill another one tomorrow if you need it.
But that high pump test will give us an answer. What do we want to do out here? It'll give us a direction on what we want to do with that well.
Okay.
You know, that's
okay,
a big revenue source right there, if you really look at it that way.
Right across the way.
In a year like we've had this year, where we have to put restrictions on water, and we've got two wells sitting there that can produce 2 million gallons of water, it's a big revenue source that we're ignoring.
And we
There's
may
no
have
doubt
some
about it.
Many takers on that.
But one of the things that made our decisions a lot easier today was the information we got from the collector's office too. So I'd like to thank the collector's office for their input and telling us that this would not be a major inconvenience to them
mm-hmm.
to go to quarterly. So thank you,
mm-hmm.
Susan and staff.
Okay. All right, so next on the agenda, Hampshire Council of Governments, HCOG, our liaison, or our elected representative, Mike Sarzynski, has tendered his resignation. He's unable to complete his term as Hadley's representative to the HCOG. This position will be on the ballot in April, but we do have a letter of interest from Donald Kupchinski, who's interested in filling the vacancy until the time of the election.
Any conflict of interest on that?
I don't see any conflict of interest. So the position would be filled until April 11th.
Yeah, where it's an elected position, so you could run for it then, you know.
Right.
I think we can, the board can administer anyone to that position at any time of vacancy.
Yeah, we have the appointment authority for that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, any discussion about that?
Did we open it up to anybody from the public? Was it made aware to?
Yeah, so I called Mr. Ford and made sure that we had jurisdiction to do this because it's a regional agency. I didn't want to overstep the jurisdictional boundaries. We talked about Mr. Paczynski's letter of interest. Thank you very much for helping out the town of Hadley. So there's two notices have been given. This has been posted.
That's the only letter we received in whatever time frame.
Right.
We needed to.
Interested in going forward with that, Donald, or you just fill in the term?
Just probably fill in the term, that's it. I've worked with a lot of these people. There's a lot of selectmen on this council already, you know, so it's nothing new, you know.
Great.
Okay, does anybody want to make a motion then?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to accept Donald's interest in the position till election time.
Second, okay. And thank you for the stepping up.
Okay, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thanks, Donald. And then the last agenda item we have is the executive session minutes review from July through December. And we have... It goes back to July 13th through December 14th. Do not release on anything like personnel matters and litigation. And then we have a handful that are able to be released.
What do you need, a motion?
Yes.
Yeah, this is standard procedure for the under the open meeting law that at least once a year that we have to review the executive sessions and determine which should be released to the public and which are still not able to be released. We did this not so long ago, but to get us back onto the regular cycle that we had gotten off on, that I'd like to do this twice a year, once in December,
so
once in July.
Twice a year.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'd like to make a motion that we release to the public records on all executive session reviews that are allowed to be released.
So moved.
At this time.
We'll do this again in July.
Yeah.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. So I think that concludes our regular agenda. And does anybody have any announcements?
I got one more thing.
John?
Somewhere down the line, can we look over this board docs and see if we can expand on that a little bit?
That note taking piece in particular?
Yeah.
That'd be good. Yep, definitely. Do you still have, I shouldn't say do you still have, but board docs came in with your predecessor, but I think there was some material that described the functionality in the expanded version?
Right, so there were two different versions of board docs, and we took the LT version, which I suppose means light. Was more affordable. We can go back and look at the... I know that they've done some upgrades to board docs in the meantime, so we can take a look at what's currently available under LT, and we can also explore what the next upgrade would be like.
Do you... maybe something we can do for town meeting warrant if we do need to fund it through our budget?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Through the selectmen's budget?
Yep.
Yep, that sounds good.
Do we have a town administrator's report today or no?
We do.
There's on the agenda, I know, so I don't know if he's prepared.
Sure, I did.
Appreciate it.
Good. You want to get the highlights, David?
So the highlights are the Bay Road Bridge project. I have called the Mass DOT to get stakeholders into one room and develop a solid plan to complete this project. I've been in contact with them throughout the fall. They've been giving me the assurances that this project's moving forward. I haven't seen anything. I know you haven't seen anything. Let's get everybody in the room and say, okay, so what really is the plan? What can we tell our the people who use that bridge, and how do we address the public safety and public works concerns associated with that?
Good thing we haven't had a huge snowstorm on there, huh?
No kidding.
Well, we've dedicated a truck, a smaller truck, that just gets under the weight limit to babysit
that. Yeah, but think of the snow that gets on the other side that just holds the weight on it.
Okay, so
is there any truth to the design phase after they looked at it again and analyzed it? I understand it's costing over $1 million, and they want to put that on hold and build a whole complete new bridge, and that's the delay now?
I was told that they have the funding for this project. I was told that the delay is the environmental permit. I can't imagine what environmental conditions exist there that would require them to delay this for a year, because if you remember, I brought this news to you back in January of last year that this was a problem. So, you know, I'm all for the environment, but I mean, how much is a repair job going to impact the conditions there? So I really want them to communicate better with us about this project and get it moving forward.
I called Stan Rosenberg's office, and I called the governor's office, actually, to see if they were holding up the money or what they were doing with this. And what two offices told me was it's $1 million for repair, and they've got the environmental issues are there, whether they do the repair or whether they do the replacement.
Right.
And they're really seriously thinking about the replacement rather than a repair at this point because of the cost of $1 million to do the repair. So what I told both offices when I called them both, I said, well, we need to let the public know what's going on. I don't think the people will have a problem that you're not spending $1 million on a repair if you're going to replace the whole bridge in another year. But let the citizens and the people and the people that are using that road know what is happening here.
I quite agree, and you know, if it's bad news or good news, tell us. We can deal with that. It's the uncertainty that drives us nuts.
The convenience of a permanent repair would be good rather than be inconvenience twice.
Yeah.
I agree.
All right. So I touched upon the Commonwealth Compact. I had a conversation with the Department of Revenue representative. They have completed their report. It's going through the editing phase, coordinating that with schedules, so we should expect to see their report in the next 10 days in time for us to implement those recommendations for town meeting. Zaterka Park is doing very well. The clearing and grubbing has been put on hold until further notice. Weather conditions permitting, they'll get back to that, and they're developing bid specifications for the next part. We went through the town meeting warrant. Safety committee got the grant for the transponders for the fire vehicles, and so we'll be installing those. The ballot election January 10th. 9 ballot questions will be decided by Hadley voters. Tuesday, January 10th, polling hours are noon to 8. Polling location is Hopkins Academy. Educational flyer was sent out with the December tax bills. And I received a phone call. A person left a voice message, didn't identify themselves or give me a phone number to call them back. So I hope that they're watching right now. They were very concerned about the wording of the ballot questions, and their concern was that the wording was such that it gave the select board the ability to borrow in the future and place that cost on the taxpayers. And I just want to say that that's not the case, that we can only borrow for what is approved by town meeting vote, and that town meeting vote has to occur by a two-thirds majority of the people there. So it's always important for people to come to town meeting, and the select board do not have carte blanche to borrow for whatever they want to. They have to borrow what they said that they would borrow for the projects that were approved by town meeting vote. Financial management team update. We met with the school department to improve the accounting service processes in order to pay vendors more timely and to address school payroll matters. There's a bunch of warrants for you to sign. I think we have the signatures for that, but that's a catch-up process, housekeeping matter. We've also, we talked about the free cash and the stabilization policies and the one-time revenue policies. Financial management team will meet after the ballot election of January 10th in order to implement the will of the voters on the request of borrowings. The audit for 16 is underway, and everything else is working just fine.
Excellent. Thank you.
And how about the new fire truck is in?
New fire truck's been in. I saw it.
I did too.
It's a
beauty.
Yes, it is. Big and yellow.
Big and white. Yellow and white.
Well, yellow and white with flashing. I got to ring the bell.
Very nice.
So they'll be doing further equipping of that. They'll be doing training. But it is in, and so we thank the Hadley voters for that. Needed apparatus to ensure public safety.
It's going to be a little bit of training.
We're going to take pictures of the new equipment that came in this year and put it on the
annual report.
I think each department should.
Each department, yeah.
I believe we should.
And a little thank you to the citizens.
Yep.
I wanted to put the fire truck on the back of the annual report as the back page.
That would be nice.
As the nice, glossy, shiny fire.
Mm-hmm.
If that's okay with you.
Sounds good.
Okay, any other announcements this evening?
I'd just like to make a comment to the fire department, the extra work they put in to make room for that truck. They went over and beyond, mm-hmm. cleaning everything out, transporting, mm-hmm. porting it to Hampshire Mall, mm-hmm. and they've got plenty of room inside there once again.
That's good. Just one comment, too. I'd like to extend our sincere sympathy to the family of Dorothy Nealand, who passed away on January 1st, so our sympathies from the select board.
Jerry, you have something?
I do. It's just kind of feedback from the meeting last night from the building committees.
Mm-hmm.
We need some information regarding, and I need it myself too, whether we need to set up emails, because all our private emails are now, if we're communicating, our private emails are now subject to being reviewed by the state.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we need to figure out what we're going to do about that, whether we set up email addresses for everybody to access or
yeah.
what. But certainly I don't think people want their emails to be
yeah.
subject to review from the state.
I've had it from the day I set foot on the school committee.
That you have an individual email address that's set up separate from your regular email
right.
address.
Right, just mkeegan
like
at hadleyma.gov.
Yeah, will this expand?
Now everybody knows.
Yeah.
Will this expanded board docs have something like that?
Not board docs, no. It would be through the...
just our exchange.
Yeah, through the virtual town halls for the website.
Okay. And that can be added to these? You know?
Well, we're working with Paragus right now in order to set this up, because we recognize that the public's right to know is a pillar of our free and democratic society, but it's also a burden on volunteer forms of government, because... You know, you're quite right. Your private email, if you use it for governmental work, is now subject to public records requests.
Yeah.
We certainly don't want to discourage volunteerism.
I think we need to get that information out to all the boards at this mm-hmm. point in time, so that they understand that and what we're working on to solve that problem.
Yep.
Okay. The warrant article information will be on the website tomorrow.
Yes.
Okay. There was some concern that the website needs some upgrading.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I guess that some of the information on it is
dated.
Somewhat dated.
Yeah.
So they were wondering if we could get to that.
Sounds like we might have a
helper
here.
I'm working on it. Little by little, I really am.
Okay, our OPM proposals came in on two buildings.
Yeah,
right.
Okay, did we get copies of that?
Yep.
Okay. There's been... One of the things they were talking about last night is that with some upgrades that are getting done down over there, and this is just kind of a to talk about, they've done some equipment upgrade, not equipment, but they've done some things to the safety complex, which is going to save them, they think, about half of their gas bill. for the year. So they're saying, we're putting the monies into it, we're saving a lot of money on the gas bill, but yet none of that money ever comes back. They're looking to fund, like I said, the maintenance for the community. Is there any way for monies that's saved based on information and technology that gets put in place to be folded into a maintenance setup if we can justify where the savings are? Let's talk about electricity, gas prices, and not gas prices, but gas conservation. There's new doors on the building, there's new insulation in the attic, there's new roofs going on the building. Like I said, they think there's a significant amount of their gas bill that's going to be reduced because of that, and if they could look at ways to capture some of that money and put it back into a funding mechanism for other maintenance things that they'd like to do, they'd like to see about doing it that way.
There's been a lot of little things throughout the years, you know. On a sewer plant, we put insulated doors in, the oil bill went dropped in half. You know, you got the two waste oil burners at the highway garage that basically don't use any oil at all anymore, you know. Things like that that we really saved quite a bit of money on, yeah.
I'm not looking for answers tonight, but I said they're thinking outside the box.
Sure.
We're investing into the community. We're investing into that. We're savings and bringing savings available to it. Maybe that can be a funding mechanism for doing bigger and better things that they're doing. And my hat's off to them for coming up with the idea. I told them I'd bring it before the board.
Yeah. So I'm just thinking through the process of, you know, in the normal course of things, if you save a dollar on heating oil, it gets put into free cash, and then that's available for what are the projects you're talking about. I don't think a revolving fund would work very well here, but we can explore that, and I can explore with the financial management team other mechanisms for getting that information, that money, back to where it needs to go.
Okay.
We also just
I think
it would
be more important to give them a budget that's adequate for them to do their work.
Yes. Exactly right. That's you what
know.
I'm thinking too.
We're talking earlier though about not using, you know, reserve. I mean, you know,
free
the money said.
But this money will end up going, like you said, free cash or back into the general fund, anyways, and it could be used to appropriate in other areas. Yeah. We had to.
So we are working on a consolidated building maintenance budget that would be under the Department of Public Works, the 490 budget, but we were looking at public safety, we're looking at the library, we're looking at council on aging. What are the kinds of things that the department heads over there do that we really don't want them to be doing? Do you want your chief of police to worry about the service contract on the elevator over the public safety complex? Or do you want your chief of police working on issues having to do with solving crimes and keeping the peace? So we were working, four of us, on that consolidated budget just this afternoon. So that's an opportunity for us to get that kind of money flowing that you're talking about.
You know, the other thing that we were throwing around was it still can be under the DPW, but a regular maintenance department, you know?
Exactly. Yeah.
For the whole town.
Which is really the suggestion of the municipal building committee in the first place. So I think,
you know,
to Jerry's
to,
point, they've been asking for it. We need to get back to them and let them know that.
Yeah. You know, we've got the committee in place just like we did with the cable committee, you know. Give that building committee a little bit more authority.
Yeah, but I don't think the highest and best use of their time is focused on day-to-day maintenance. I mean,
no,
they'd like to get it off their plate.
Exactly.
They want to get this where it belongs. They want the funding to be in place and to be somewhat closer to where it needs to be and justify where it needs to be, and then go look at a different project.
So what we're looking at now is just municipal buildings and none of the school buildings?
That's correct.
Right now they're segregated.
Right.
Maybe eventually it could all be incorporated someday.
Maybe well.
Possibly to save
it's
money
an opportunity.
Too.
Opportunity.
You know, but at this point I understand.
Yeah, if the community wished to go with a full-blown central maintenance department, then it would be all town buildings. But that would be way down the road, I guess.
Yeah, you're saying hiring a plumber, hiring an electrician,
yeah,
maybe a carpenter, more so even. Yeah.
We need to several people have been asking about absentee ballots for the override votes next week.
January 10th.
And my understanding is absentee ballots are available.
Right. I'll talk about the town clerk.
Yeah.
I think people need to know that if they're not going.
we have such odd hours for this election. It's 12 to 8, so, you know, some people go to work at 7 in the morning and don't come home until 9 o'clock at night, you know, if they're traveling to Boston or Connecticut or whatever. I mean, sometimes it's not
in... going to a select board meeting.
Well, you're only Greenfield. Yeah. But, you know, you sometimes they don't have an opportunity.
Oh,
so
you moved into town, you're going to vote?
So anyway, people would have that opportunity. They have, do they have Monday to do it also?
Let me go on the town website and see what I can find out.
Just so we can, so it's from 12 to 8 on January 10th.
Okay, anything else?
Motion adjourned.
Wait, he's just looking up one quick thing.
Okay.
We'll be off before 8:30 for a change.
Okay, absentee, it's all on the town clerk's website. Everything you need to know, it's right there.
Okay, so what is the answer?
You want me to look?
It's time to go.
All right. The deadline to apply for absentee ballots is the noon the day before the election.
Okay.
So Monday.
So noon on Monday.
Noon on Monday.
Okay. Now, does anybody want to entertain a motion?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thanks, everybody. Good night.
Welcome, Drew. Nice to meet you.